Last time in the Megastructures series, we looked at building artificial worlds whose gravity was supplied by rotating them. Today, we're going to be looking at building ones which have their gravity supplied normally, by sheer mass. Now, building a planet is obviously a pretty serious endeavor, and it uses up a lot of material, but in and of itself, it's not high-tech. Like a lot of these, it's really more of a resource-intensive affair. Here on Earth, for every square foot of land, there's about a megaton of rock and magma underneath you. For a rotating habitat, even a pretty elaborate and bulky one, a couple of tons a square foot works. So artificial plants of this variety are usually considered impractical, but they are a lot more appealing to a lot of people, so today we're going to talk about a variation of this concept that is a bit more practical, Shellworlds. The concept behind a Shellworld is that you don't need to make the whole thing out of rock and metal, which are rare compared to other things like hydrogen and helium. Done as a thin skin of rock and water and air around some filler material, a Shellworld wouldn't use any more material than a rotating habitat except for the filler, which could be hydrogen or helium in a low-tech version, or could be stuff like artificial black holes or dark matter, which we'll get to in a bit. The other advantage of Shellworlds is they let you build artificial planets at different sizes and still have Earth normal gravity. You can tailor the gravity to be higher or lower than Earth's own, but the real appeal of a Shellworld is that you can replicate Earth for all practical purposes. So let's start with a quick look at gravity. When you're outside a spherical object, the gravity on you is linear to its total mass and inverse square to its radius. Which is to say, if you double the mass, you double that gravitational force. If you triple the mass, triple the force. Alternatively, double your distance and the force falls to a quarter. Triple and it drops it to a ninth. Get 10 times further away and it's just 100th, 1%. But if you scale up something like Earth, doubling its radius, you won't have the same gravity at the surface. Volume rises with the cube, so it gets 2 cubed or 8 times the mass, and so 8 times the gravitational force. But the distance has also risen by double, so the force drops to a quarter. 8 divided by 4 is 2, so the scaled up Earth has twice the surface gravity. We don't want that. So the fix would be to use a filler that was half as dense, so that it had half the total mass. Similarly, if you want a planet half the size of Earth, but with the same gravity at the surface, you need a filler that was twice as dense. That's why gas like hydrogen or helium comes in so handy. You can change its pressure and density. Do it right, and you can even have a hot and pressurized gas counteracting the weight of the shell so it doesn't need to be as strong. I sometimes think of this subset of a Shellworld as a balloon world. The inside of a balloon is at higher pressure than the air outside it to counteract the tension in the balloon, and this is the same concept. In fact, done right, you could even get away with a magma layer and tectonic plates. But the key thing is that your filler's density, to get the same gravity as Earth, is inverse to its size compared to Earth. Whatever the diameter or radius is in comparison to Earth, the density of your filler material is inverse to that. Triple your diameter and you need a third the density for your filler. Build a planet a tenth the diameter of Earth and you need a filler 10 times denser. The other aspect is that regardless of how big or small you build one of these things, you use the same amount of mass per square foot, 1 megaton. Whether your Shellworld is a few dozen miles across or as big as Saturn, your living area costs you 1 million tons of metal per square foot. Saturn's a great example of this because it is about 100 times Earth's mass, and 10 times the diameter. If you built a shell around Saturn, the gravity would be Earth normal, and you'd have a planet with 100 times the living area of Earth. Now all that actually matters is the average density. The matter can be all crunched up into one spot, like if you dumped an artificial black hole somewhere and built a shell around it. If you're building a shell that isn't being supported by internal pressure, it has to be very strong. If you've got some very rigid and strong material, you're fine. But in many of these cases, the strength needed way exceeds what any known material can handle. This is where orbital rings we discussed back in the first Megastructures video come into play. By using a stream of particles orbiting a planet normally, just like a planet ring, you can magnetically levitate material over that. You can go back and review that video if you want the details on how that works. So you build a ring. It appears as a solid object that is not moving, though in reality it's got its own fill of material orbiting the planet, akin to a hose turned into a donut full of moving water. The more mass you pile onto that ring, the faster the material inside needs to go to hold it up. Now you can build another ring at a different angle, running a hair higher or lower. These don't actually have to be perfect circles either, they can be ellipses, but circles would be preferable by and large, and we're building a sphere anyway. You build another ring at a different angle, and another, until you've got a mesh big enough to comfortably handle your shell, and you dump dirt and water and air on it. Now, you'd probably never build a shell world like this unless you had figured out controlled fusion, both because you need access to that kind of energy source to build such a thing in the first place, and keep its ring stable, but also because that's what the force justification is for such a mass expensive process in comparison to rotating habitats. If you've got controlled fusion, or artificial black holes, then hydrogen and helium become very important to you, and you'd like to be able to keep your stockpiles in nice, accessible chunks. I mentioned earlier that you need a megaton of matter per square foot of living area on these regardless of their size, and to put that in terms of energy, if you start off with a filler made entirely of hydrogen and converted it to helium, you get about 6.3 times 10 to the 23rd joules of energy per megaton. Now, the average solar illumination on Earth is about 30 watts per square foot, or about a billion joules per year per square foot. So that means your filler mass would provide fusion fuel to run your world for about 600 trillion years, more than 100,000 times longer than our sun has left to its life. You're basically using your filler mass as your power supply, either by using very tall lighthouses or a fake sun actually orbiting your planet. When that's over, you've lost about 0.7% of your mass, so your surface gravity would only be 99.3% of what it was 600 trillion years ago. That's a very long time to adapt to a minuscule gravity difference, but if you really want to stay the same, you can slowly shrink your world just a little to keep it the same. Now, if you can tap into black holes or raw matter to energy conversion, you can extend that lifespan 100-fold more and keep shrinking your world to keep the gravity the same, which would also reduce the amount of power it needs, extending that lifetime even further. So shell worlds, while way more mass-intensive than rotating habitats, actually aren't over sufficiently long timelines, since if you're building for the very long term, your mass requirement is mostly for energy supplies. I mentioned in our discussion of rotating habitats that you keep your fusion fuel in non-rotating tanks spaced around the habitat that also provided shielding from radiation and meteor impacts. But if you're building for a trillion-year civilization, then you might as well keep your fuel inside where it can provide gravity. You might also use shell worlds on pre-existing worlds like Earth or Mars, since it lets you slowly extract the rocky material inside and replace it with pressurized tanks of gas or buried orbital rings to be switched on. A lot of times when we talk about Dyson spheres or Dyson swarms, I get asked if I think we'd eventually disassemble Earth to provide more material, and I would actually bet the answer is no, that we'd hollow it out instead. But this brings up Matryoshka variants of the shell world. In this, every shell world has many layers instead. I would actually bet that Earth itself is destined for some version of this, because we are likely to be pretty attached to our home world. You can construct another shell around the first, then another, and you could also go down too. Keeping gravity at the same everywhere isn't all that hard either. The interesting thing about a spherical shell of matter is that if you're inside it, you don't feel any gravity at all. It all cancels out. So every layer above you on the shell world that you build has no effect on the gravity of the shells below you. Alternatively, the mass of that shell does affect the people living on it or above it on higher layers. So you just need to make sure each layer has the right total mass based on its distance. As an example, ignoring air for the moment, if I built a shell 40 miles over the Earth, which is about 1% of its radius, we'd expect gravity to drop by about 2%, meaning we'd need to add about 2% of the Earth's mass to that shell to keep the gravity right. Another layer, 80 miles up, we need about 4% of Earth's mass to work, but you can count that lower layer against the total. A Matryoshka shell can get very large indeed, just so long as your average density is decreasing to match that. Since air is about 5,000 times less dense than Earth, and about 1,000 times less dense than water, you can build some monstrously big walls before this becomes an issue. Now, you can't just build a big globe of air without compressing it to higher densities, but if you've got layers of shells, you can prevent that. And you can even have lower densities near the vacuum if those layers are far enough apart, same as our own natural atmosphere, decreased in density as you get up higher. Your individual layers can be a few hundred feet high or a few hundred miles high, depending on what you're aiming for. Of course, if you have a layered shell world like this, you need to provide artificial lighting, and you'd have to worry about getting rid of heat. Neither plants nor human eyes need the level of lighting provided by noontime clear sky sunlight, so you can dim that down a lot. You can also pump heat outwards. A lot of these designs use a variation of the space fountain we discussed back in the third video of the series to hoard up the sky in addition to orbital rings, and you can channel heat up that way too. Your actual top layer could just be a normal landscape, but you might want to abandon that layer to a highly effective heat pump with a bumpy surface to maximize how much heat you'll radiate away. In some versions of these with black holes in the middle, you might go the other way and pump your heat into the black hole, but that would depend a lot on how the thermodynamics of black holes actually work, and we don't know for sure if you can just dump heat into a black hole like that. If it is doable, then there's no real limit on your layers. If you need to vent heat via infrared radiation, though, then you can only do so many layers, and you'd probably be capped out at a bit under 100. Sometimes we kick around the notion of the largest possible artificial world you can build, and this is an example since you could do this around, for instance, a white dwarf or neutron star and use them for power. Even around a galactic core black hole, since those are about a trillion times more massive than Earth, you get a trillion times more area on your shell, whereas even a Dyson sphere only provides about a billion times the living area, and each layer would double that. Such a structure would be wider than the orbit of Pluto, but it does have the mass energy of a million suns to run it, so it could stay powered for time increments way longer than stars normally live. I've always liked this concept because the notion of a massive world with many trillions of times the living area of Earth, located at the center of the galaxy, just seems like the ultimate galactic empire capital. Now, a common theme of these is always their longevity. Even their natural gravity helps prevent leakage of gases from slowly losing material. That's why I mention white dwarf stars and neutron stars and black holes in context of these a lot. You really don't gain much by building these unless you're aiming for very long-lasting civilizations, ones that outlast normal stars. Of course, if we ever find a way to manipulate dark matter, which is the supermajority of matter in the universe and far larger in quantity than rocky matter, it would also make a superb filler material. We don't know much about dark matter yet besides that it generates gravity, so if you could gather and contain it, then it might have all sorts of useful purposes. But the one we do know for sure would be using it as filler material to generate gravity. It's entirely possible that might be its only use, though sweeping it up and keeping it inside a shell is something we can't do at the moment, and may be outright impossible. Shellworlds are fun for fiction, though rather underused even there, and this particular video series is as much about fiction concepts as pure science, so they are worth looking at. Usually they get dismissed as something you never actually build just because they use so much mass compared to something like a rotating habitat, but if you are building for the super long term, or if you want a place like Earth to remain essentially intact but be bigger, they do start becoming realistically practical. So they aren't limited to examples of things you'd only ever build just because you can. Next time we're going to take a look at something that you really only would ever build just because you can, by taking a look at flat Earth disk worlds. And we'll try to show that they aren't actually all that impractical after all. If you want a reminder of when that and other videos come out, click the subscribe button. And don't forget to like and share the video if you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.